Time to welcome founder chairman of Banyan Tree Holdings and Singapore Management University, and the man whose thoughts make up the book we're reading today, Asking Why, Ho Kwan Ping. Welcome to the program.
Thank you.
You're known as an immensely successful businessman and intellectual. And in chapter one, you write, "My life has been a journey of ironies and contradictions, punctuated by moments of near despair and joyful purpose." Which critical moments in your life have you found it difficult to find answers to the questions that you have, or to the questions why? And how do you resolve that very tension of wanting to ask why, and then the realization that the answer may be extremely difficult to find or face?
Well, there have certainly been a lot of moments of near despair or full despair, even at a young age. I suppose when I was first jailed in the U.S., and then I was jailed several years later in Singapore, when I was suspended from university, when our businesses were faced with financial crisis. So that's not chronological, but there have been, you know, quite a number of times when things really didn't seem to be working out at all. And then you ask yourself, why did I get myself into this trouble? And what should I do to get out of it? And I think it's important, I found in my life, to question established things, orthodoxies and so on, but also questioning yourself and what's the motivation for you to do various things.
So what keeps you going through those moments of despair?
Well, my wife likes to say to me that I'm a born optimist. So I always do see things as half full rather than half empty. And also because I think there's not much point to despair. I'm also a pretty idealistic and yet pretty practical person. What's the point of getting depressed too long? It doesn't help any situation. So you should just pick yourself up and ask yourself, why did you do this? Was it honest? Are you being honest with yourself? And should you be doing this or that instead? And then at the end of it, come to terms with whatever you're doing and whatever situation you're in and move on.
One of your early failures was building the then largest offshore oil rig in China.
Oh, yeah.
When you were 2 years into heading your father's company.
Absolutely.
You joined the business when you were just 29. But this was the early 80s and the bottom would fall out of the global oil industry. And the Chinese oil minister, who had promised to buy but did not in the end, well, scuppered things. How did your late father react to that failure?
He has a far different temperament than mine. I'm a bit more like my mother, quick to temper, but quick to also cool down. My father was the quintessential Chinese gentleman, always humble, always principled. I've never actually even had a chance to have an argument with him, even though I've wanted to argue with him many times, and he was just far too calm. So he took it all in stride when I lost so much money. In fact, it was him who counseled me to sell at a huge loss because I had wanted to hold on to the rig, thinking the global situation would turn around. And of course, in retrospect, if I had continued to do what I had wanted to do, we would have been bankrupted. But after that episode, I had lost so much money for the family company that I volunteered to resign. And he said, "You can do so after you make back all your losses." And that's all he ever said about it.
Speaking of family, you write, "First among equals, our children are close to us because we treat them as equals." Speaking of your children,
they won't say that though. They won't say that.
Okay, so the reality is
different. I say that. Well, you could ask them separately. They'll say probably near equals, and for public consumption, they'll say the parents will tell people that they treat them as equals. I should say we try to treat them as equals when it's convenient for us.
Yeah, I'd love to find out what philosophical touch, you know, what is the touchstone of how you approach building a family?
I mean, I say jokingly about how we treat them as equals, but I do think there's a lot of truth in that. Obviously, we treat them as people, I think is more like it, rather than as stereotype kids and this and that. Every one of them is an individual whose individuality we really note. And as my kids have gotten older, I mean, my eldest son is married and giving me my second grandchild.
Congratulations.
And my daughter is going to give me my third grandchild, both In October, so great things are going to happen soon. And our youngest son has just graduated from university, he's going to do his master's program, so they're all full of doubts. And I think, I like to think that we are really very good friends because we communicate across this idea of I'm just a dad with the authority of a dad and so on. I think we do talk very openly about things, and it's been a long time since I've ever had to exert parental privilege.
This book is great because it gives us insight into what you consider valuable and how you think and how you approach life. Looking back, it's been reported that the first hotel, your name, of course, synonymous with Banyan Tree, it's been reported that the first hotel you built in Phuket, Thailand, proved difficult because of its lack of a beachfront. But that then inspired you to build villas rather than rooms with their own stunning pools. So when you look back, was it your creative reaction to what had been maybe an insurmountable obstacle to somebody else, you know, a beach that, a lack of a beachfront? Is it your creative approach to obstacles that is part of what it takes to build a business and a brand?
Well, it's part of what I've always said about the nature of innovation. I don't think innovation drops from the sky. It's not this, you know, like Archimedes sitting in the bathtub and then suddenly having a eureka moment or... I think that's romanticizing innovation. 90% of the time, innovation is a response to a problem.
Mm.
And it can be all kinds of problems. I like to use the fact that the musical part of iPhone came from an iPod, and iPod came from the Discman, and the Discman came from the founder of Sony, Akio Morita, who basically was a classical music fan. And he just found it a real pain because classical music was so long that whenever he got on the move, he had to switch off the music. And he said he wanted to create a portable way of listening to classical music. That's how portable music started, is a response to a problem that he had. We had a practical problem. We had a piece of land that had no beachfront. I was far too young and stupid to realize you shouldn't build beach resorts without a beachfront. But having started on it, we asked ourselves, what are we going to do now? And so we said, let's build pools for each one of the villas. And then we further said, let's build a spa. And so the idea of tropical garden spas and a tropical pool villas, the idea of tropical pool villas, which is now, you know, ordinary everywhere, started with Banyan Tree, and it was our response to practical problems. And that's how innovation is manifesting itself 90% of the time.
There's a chapter in the book called Curbing the Rise of the Hero CEO. And speaking of problems and reactions to problems, you write, in a speech entitled Whimsically, If I Could Remodel Society, I listed several ideas. One that elicited the most applause was a suggestion that an investment banker's bonus above 6 months' salary be taxed at 70% and the money redistributed to primary and secondary school teachers who are the most important transmitters of values after parents. This was a suggestion made only half in jest. The part not to be taken seriously was the possibility of its adoption. What did you want to say about the values in society, the ordering of values, and the status of people as important as teachers in that particular excerpt?
I'm by no means a socialist in thinking that everyone should be paid according to need. And obviously, investment bankers create a lot of wealth and so on and so forth. But I think one has to also be realistic now, that realistic at looking at compensation schemes around the world. People who, of course, make billions of dollars for their companies get compensated by huge amounts. But I think all of us remember that some of the most influential people in our own lives were our primary and secondary school teachers, not even university teachers. They taught us values, they taught us self-confidence, they taught us so many important things. And yet they are recognized and compensated the most poorly. It's, to me, terribly inspiring when I find, and I encourage my children to do that. Every time they come back from overseas or they've done well and graduated well, I always tell them, go and visit your primary school teachers. And it's incredible to me how teachers compensated simply by seeing their students coming back and seeing how successful their students have been. I look at policemen, I look at armed forces people. There are so many people in this world who contribute far more than those who have been paid 100 times more. That is the inequality of capitalism, and we live in a capitalist order, and we have to accept it. But I do think we sometimes need to question fundamentally whether this is right. And so I say it only half in jest, but I think it is not going to happen. You're not going to get school teachers paid as much as investment bankers. And perhaps there's something wrong with that. But at least we should, from time to time, give recognition to the really important people in society.
If you could remodel society, which critical topics that matter would benefit from public debate?
One of the things about compensation, and this is compensation for CEOs as well as highly paid people in the public and possibly further sector, which I don't need to name, is the fact that in a capitalist system, you will have inequality. But I think it makes a lot of sense, as it's now actually being discussed in the West about CEO salaries, that perhaps CEO salaries should be pegged as a multiple, a fixed multiple, maybe 50 times more, 60 times more, whatever it might be, but as a much higher multiple of the average salary of, say, the average person in a company. Mm. Or if it's political leaders, 50, 60 times more than the average income of a person in that of the average person in that country, however you want to measure it, so that at least there's some link between the highest paid persons and the lowest paid persons. And there's also an incentive for those who are leaders of a company or a country that if they want to get a higher salary, it will only be when they uplift also the average income of people under their charge. This kind of debate is actually, interestingly, finally beginning to be held in Western countries about CEO compensation.
And do you think it's going to make its way here?
I've actually raised it. I was at a Institute of Directors conference talking about good governance, and I lamented the fact that everybody is talking about the inequalities of globalization and 1% getting 90% of income, etc. But nobody who is in the elite world, directors and CEOs, are willing to actually suggest practical things by which the inequality gap can be somewhat breached.
Part of the problem is it's peer groups that are in charge in this world, and you do talk about
peer
that.
How groups reward each other always, all the time. It's I scratch your back, you scratch mine. It's that's the reality of the world, and I've lived long enough to recognize that. People don't like to say that, but if you look at compensation committees for companies, they're always comprising other peers.
Hmm. Well, speaking of speaking up, you've experienced, as you mentioned, being a political detainee. You spent 2 months in a Singapore prison back in 1977 after you stirred controversy with your work as economics editor for the Far Eastern Economic Review. Your book is titled Asking Why. Do you think it's sort of fair to expect the man on the street, the average reader, to challenge the status quo, given you are a very example of wrongful detention following a perceived challenge to the nation's leaders or style of governance?
I have emphasized several times that asking why does not necessarily require you to be a contrarian. I've actually used the example that some of the people whom are my friends and are the most religious are people who were born into their religion and then questioned it tremendously and came in a roundabout way to adopt the religion in which they were born in.
Mm.
My point about asking why is that you should ask why or why not, but it doesn't mean that you have to come to a conclusion that is necessarily contrarian to the social order, the political order, etc. My only point was that we are accountable to ourselves to not just accept the orthodox truths which we are given all the time. And we need to think for ourselves. The counterpoint to asking why actually is the concept of thinking for yourself, not other people think for you. So if you really, I've always said too, that thinking why is to me, the fundamental basis of all leadership in the world. If you look at in the political world, Nelson Mandela, Mahatma Gandhi asked, why is it that people of color must be discriminated against?
Mm.
And they didn't get a good answer. And so it led them to be political leaders. Isaac Newton and Galileo asked why of the physical world. And why is it the world is like this and not like that? And they discovered gravity and so on. So it's only when you ask why and look for answers that we get progress in this world.
Do you think that a society's context sort of casts a shadow about over people in terms of whether they feel they can speak up?
The antithesis of asking why is conformity. And the conformity is not always imposed from outside. It's not always imposed by your parents, your teachers, or the government. I think that's probably only 60, 40% of the case. I think the majority of conformity is actually self-induced. We want to fit in. We don't want to be laughed at. We don't want to ask questions and then people laughing and snickering at you for asking questions. We want to fit in. We want to be like everybody else. And that need for conformity, I think, is a big problem, especially for young people. When you're old at my age, we can be eccentric. Nobody really cares. Young people really want to fit in so badly, they don't want to question anything. And it's particularly young people that I encourage, think for yourself.
How did your 2 months in prison, sometimes in solitary confinement, shape you as a human being? And did the experience of wrongful arrest have any impact on your questioning spirit?
Well, wrongful arrest, twice, has made me much more careful, a lot less headstrong. I don't think it has affected my asking why. As I've continued to ask why of things, it has tempered my response to asking why and, you know, being less outrageous than I might have been. But I think imprisonment has also made me more honest to myself about who I am and whom I'm not. And very interestingly, Anwar Ibrahim was in Singapore last week at the Singapore summit, and so I had a time to actually ask him a few questions about what he learned in solitary confinement. Mine was only 2 months. He spent years in solitary confinement. And it's unbelievable what that can do to you in terms of either destroying you as a person or you're coming to terms with yourself and strengthening yourself by knowing exactly who you are and who you're not.
Why do you think, unlike other political detainees, you've gone on to work in such prominent positions in Singapore?
I don't know. Well, people who are not so friendly towards me would say I have sold out my principles. I should have held to my principles and be forever anti-government. I would prefer to think that I have come to terms with what I was and was not, that sometimes my activism and speaking out was perhaps a little bit out of ego and other reasons of being headstrong. I like to think that who I am today is a person I can live with, sometimes critical of the government and oftentimes very strongly supportive of our government. And I don't think I don't need to adopt a position that conforms with what are other people's expectations of me, as long as I'm honest to myself.
You write in the book, you're in the autumn of your life. You are 66. After a lifetime of asking why, what do you know for sure?
Well, I know for sure what the Japanese have said about old age and that I'm hardly old. I'm not sure whether you're aware the Japanese in all their wisdom have defined that, like we have always defined youth in many stages, right? From toddler to infant, toddler, adolescence and so on. Mm-hmm. But when you get past 60, it's kind of like, bang, you're old. The Japanese have redefined it really greatly. They have three stages of middle age. Early middle age, middle age, and late middle age. So 65 to 75 ain't old. It's late middle age.
Hey, that sounds great.
So, so I'm only late middle age. I ain't old yet.
What a great spirit. Great talking to you. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you very
Fabulous
much.
Fabulous book. Asking Why, my guest today, Ho Kwan Ping. You've been reading. I'm Michelle Martin.